All right, so welcome to the class. I also, in addition to the recordings, which are available, I will post the example. So if you're having trouble seeing something on the board, you can always download the example. All right, let's begin by going over some of the things in Canvas of how this course is structured. I don't intend on going over everything now. I will hit the highlights, so to speak. And I will point out some things that it would be good for you to review within the next week or so, because we will talk about them sometime in the future. So I imagine you all know Canvas. I think you have to get an orientation for it or something, at least if you're in an online class. But at any rate, let's go over how I have stuff organized in Canvas. If someone could get the lights, please. Projector is not working. Well, all right. Well, then we're going to have a very abbreviated review of that. If you can turn the lights back on. What I will do is I will mention the things that I want you to read, and I will still talk about them, even though you don't have them necessarily. You won't be able to see them in front of you. You can pull them up. First of all, I would urge you to log on to Canvas at least a few times a week between classes, even if you don't have any, like, reason to. The reason I say that is that I will post announcements, all right? For example, if I give an extension on a deadline, or if there was a mistake I made in class, or I want to clarify something, or someone asks a question and I think it would be good for you to see the answer to it, I will post an announcement to Canvas to do that. So, you know, log in, you know, sometime between the Tuesday and Thursday session, log in sometime over the weekend, just to see if there's any announcements that are made. Canvas is primarily the way that I will communicate with you. That's how you'll submit your work, and that's how I will give feedback back to you. So log in, there's announcements that cover what to do. The syllabus. Let me point out a few things in the syllabus that I want to review. And this will be like SpongeBob, right? You have to use your imagination to picture the syllabus. The very top of the syllabus, there's a list of ways to get hold of me, all right? And I have office hours on Monday through Thursday, and the exact times are listed. I also have a phone number. I have an email address, and you can email me either through my regular email address or through Canvas. If you have questions, you can come in during my office hours. You can come in during, you certainly have the lab period of this class to get your questions clarified. All right. If you can't make it on campus or you can't make it during the office hours, I can Skype with you, and I have my Skype ID with you. On there. But just let me know if you're going to add me on Skype, because I get all these weird requests on Skype and I don't want to accept a request if it isn't legit. All right. You can send email, and you can send email anytime. I check my email typically at least once a day. Again, I might not do it every single day literally, but pretty much one or more times a day. So I think I do a pretty good job getting email responses back to you. So if you have questions, by all means, ask them. What I try to do by presenting so many different ways for you to be able to contact me is to make it so that no matter what your circumstances are, and this goes for both the people here in the classroom and the people in the online class, you have an opportunity to get your questions answered. All right? Don't wait until you're really far behind and confused to ask questions. All right. As soon as something doesn't appear clear to you, ask for a question. You can ask during lectures, you can ask during a lab session, you can email me. What I do sometimes is I try to give you a hint so that you can figure out by yourself if you're having problems with code or something like that. Or I'll answer it, but I won't ignore your questions if you ask them. So it's good to ask them as soon as you have a problem, not wait until you're far behind. All right? It's admirable that some students want to figure out their own problems for themselves. All right? But if you take that to the extreme, that actually becomes a negative because you're a student and you're not expected to know and be able to figure out everything by yourself. And that's why I'm here as an instructor, is to help you over those bumps in the road that you're possibly going to encounter. All right, so there's a lot of ways to get a hold of me, read through the syllabus, and get a sense of them. There's a description of the class, the course outcomes, and so on. One point I like to make is this is your class. It doesn't do me any good to cover something if the people in the class aren't understanding it. All right, getting back to what I said before. Therefore, ask questions. And when you ask questions, again, the worst case scenario will be, I'll tell you, well, let's talk about it during lab. Maybe you missed a day and there's something that you just don't understand. All right? In which case, I might say, hey, let's talk about that during lab or something like that. But I promise I won't give you a hard time for asking questions or tell you, well, you should know that already or something like that. About the only time I get close to being snippy, I'll admit it, is if someone asks me something that they could easily look up on Canvas. Like, when was that date? Well, you know, what date is the assignment due? I don't have them memorized. I don't know. What would I do? I'd go and look it up on Canvas if I needed to know that. So, if you know, take a shot and look it up in Canvas. If you're still confused, then let me know. I have a whole list of college policies listed here. All right? I have a whole list of college policies listed here that you should read through and you should review to the student handbook if you have any more questions about it. I talk about my policy on late assignments, and I think I'm very flexible on late assignments. If I see students are working on an assignment, all right, and they turn it in a day or two late, that doesn't bother me at all. All right, you're students, you're still learning. You know, if you learn it a day after the due date, I'm still happy that you learned it, all right? Therefore, I reserve the right not to deduct if it's late, but I also reserve the right to deduct if it's late. So, for example, I get a few students every semester that flat out just disappear. I don't hear anything from them. I don't get emails from them. Nothing. And then, you know, week 7 or 8, I'll get lab 1 or lab 2 or something like that. In a case like that, I feel it's acceptable for me to deduct, all right? If there are some special circumstances, like, you know, you're ill or you have to go out of town and you're going to miss a week of school or something like that, feel free to drop me a line and mention it to me. And I don't want you to divulge anything that you think is too personal. So you don't have to give me details about what's going on. But just as a courtesy, let me know that something's going on and that you're going to miss a week. And I'll be a lot more flexible as far as grading it if I at least have an idea. Yes, you didn't just forget about the class or you just don't care about the class, but something came up that kept you from getting stuff in on time. So just keep the lines of communication open. All right, that's sort of the most important thing. All right? And I think compared to many professors, I have a very flexible late assignment policy. So the one thing I would say is if you're late with an assignment, that's no big deal. But if you notice that you're continually late with assignments, this assignment, maybe something needs to happen. Maybe you need to talk with me to clarify something that you're having a hard time understanding, or maybe you need to put some extra hours in working on it, or something along those lines. All right? So, that again is my take on late assignments. Some other college policies. Your grade's going to be composed of this, and I'll write this up on the board. at 5 points each. So that's 55 points. There's a portfolio, which should be easy points for you. There's two parts to the portfolio, part one and part two. There's a project, which is also in two parts. The design, and then the final project. And if I did the math right, that adds up to 100 points. All right, so 100 points in this class. Standard 90 to 100 is an A, 80 to 90 is a B, and so on down the line. All right? The homework assignments are due the Wednesday of the indicated week. So, for example, if I assign something this week, it's due the following Wednesday. So nothing is due tomorrow for you, all right? Something is due a week from Wednesday for you, the first homework assignment, all right? So all the homework assignments that I assign, if I assign it 1 week, it's due the following Wednesday. And on the syllabus, there's a list that shows what's due when. Yes?
Do you mean Thursday?
No, I mean Wednesday. But, you know, if again, keeping in mind with my late policy, if there's something, let's say you're almost done with it Tuesday in lab, and you know, you need to ask me some questions on Thursday, that's fine if you turn it in Thursday. But shoot for the Wednesday. All right. And each of these assignments will be making one or more than one web page. And I define the requirements for it, and you have to create a web page that does what I ask for. Now, one thing that I do pretty often is I'll give you an opportunity to redo an assignment if it's not completely what I expect. And I think that actually causes a lot of extra work for myself. But I really think it's worth it. Because, you know, people say you learn from your mistakes. Well, yeah, that's kind of true, right? Which, if that were really true, then I would expect the Cleveland Browns to win the Super Bowl next year, right? Because they made so many mistakes this year that they're bound to have learned quite a bit. The point is you don't necessarily learn from your mistakes. Your mistakes give you an opportunity to learn, all right? And how do you learn from your mistakes? Well, a lot of times, especially in software development, you learn from your mistakes by going back and redoing it and doing it right, all right? Think about it if you were on a job. If you were on a job and you had to create a web page that did something, if it didn't do what it was supposed to do, your boss wouldn't say, oh, okay, well, that's fine. Let's go on to the next task. You know, no, you'd correct it. All right? So I oftentimes give the opportunity to rework a web page. And so if you don't get full credit on it, you know, take the opportunity and rework it. Find out what you did wrong. And correct it and add to it. All right. I think that works out best for the students. It gives you an opportunity to learn what you did wrong, and that way, if there's any miscommunication about exactly what the assignment required, hey, no problem. Just do it right the second time. All right. Your portfolio. There's a couple documents about the portfolio, and there's a couple documents about the semester project. What I'd like you to do is definitely for next time read about the portfolio. All right. Within the next couple of weeks, read about the semester project, because we'll start talking about the semester project a few weeks into the semester. The portfolio is important that you understand right off the bat. What is a portfolio? What does it mean when I say a portfolio? Yes?
It's basically something about like work in a folder or something.
Repeat that, please.
It's basically a collection of all your work.
Yeah, a collection of your work. All right. And portfolios can be used for a number of reasons. Web developers especially use portfolios to showcase their work. So that if you are looking for a job or you are a consultant and you want business and you want to tell people, look, I can develop a great looking website, instead of just telling them that, you can show examples of your work. All right. So essentially a portfolio in this class is going to consist of you creating a page that links to each of your assignments and has some notes and so on and so forth. Read about that, and we'll talk more about that in subsequent weeks. The main point that I want to get across to you is keep a copy of every assignment because you will need to include it in your portfolio. So when you're finished with an assignment, don't delete it. All right? Keep a copy of it. The assignments in this class typically don't take up a lot of space, so you're not going to be required to have a lot of storage to keep the assignments, but definitely keep every one of your assignments so that you can assemble it in a portfolio. All right? And read about the portfolio, and we'll discuss it later within the next class or two, hopefully when we have a projector, and also read about the semester project, but read about the portfolio first. I would hope that you'd read about the portfolio and the syllabus and so on by next class. As the semester project, you can let that go within the next couple of weeks. We'll be talking about that. All righty. Let's see if there's anything else I want to talk about. Oh, the way the course is organized. There's a discussion forum where you can ask questions. Think of the discussion forum like raising your hand in class and asking a question, right? When it's a general question that you think everyone in the class would benefit from hearing. If it's a more individual question, then it's probably better to send an email. But you know what? It really doesn't matter. Just be sure that if you have a question, you ask it. There's going to be a module for each week, all right? And the module for the week contains a list of things to do this week. It may contain other examples and stuff like that, all right? And finally, it will contain your assignment for the week and with a Dropbox where you submit it. So there'll be one of these per week. The module will be posted before the Monday of the week. So in other words, week one is available now. Week two will be posted, Thursday, Friday, Saturday of this week. All right. Each week will also contain the class videos. So if you want to look for today's video, you would look in the week one module. And it typically will be posted by evening of the day that the lecture was. So the lectures in this class are Tuesdays and Thursdays, so by Tuesday evening the lecture should be available online for you online students as well. One thing that I do, by the way, in this class is, and in all my classes, is I forgot one other place that you can go for help. You can actually come to my other courses labs. Alright? My other lab is Monday and Wednesday from 10 to 11 a.m. So if you are on campus during that time, feel free to come to my lab if you have additional questions. I allow all my labs, I allow any of my students, whether you be online or campus-based, to come on in and sit through them. All right? Just another opportunity for you to get questions answered. All right. Now, this is going to be a little bit of a challenge because I do not have a projector. But I'm going to write on the board. And I will, as I'm writing on the board, I will enter an example. And I'll upload it to Canvas so that you can actually look at the file. But because I can't project it, I will simply have to show you stuff on the board. First of all, what are some of the things that are on web pages? What do web pages consist of? Pardon me?
Text.
All right, what else?
HTML.
Okay, HTML, let's hold that thought to the side. All right.
Images.
What else?
Links.
What else?
Videos, possibly.
Possibly videos or other multimedia. Right, that's pretty much what web pages consist of. Have you ever gone to a web page and click the view source option?
Yeah.
All right, you can do that. And when you do that, what do you see? You see a plain text file. You can actually read the file. All right. The language that web pages are written in is called HTML. HTML stands for what?
Hypertext markup language.
Hypertext markup language. Let's look at this. Let's look at that name. Two parts. You know, let's break it into two parts. Hypertext means beyond regular text. In other words, the big innovation that web pages offer is they have link text, right? The web was created by Tim Berners-Lee, who worked for the nuclear something in Europe. CERN is the name of the place. And I don't know what the initials stand for, but is the European nuclear scientist do that. And his idea was this. If you can imagine, if you read a paper, let's say you're reading a paper in an academic journal. At the end of the paper, a lot of times there's a bibliography that says, hey, I use this as a source, I use that as a source. His thought was, back in the old days, what would you have to do? Well, you'd have to go to the library and see if you could find that other article that was referred to. Let's say I'm reading a paper about quarks or some nuclear physics topic. And someone talked about quarks in their paper. And I might have a footnote in a paper about that. Well, in the old days, if you wanted to find where that footnote came from, you'd have to go to the library and find that other article. What Berners-Lee's idea was, is wouldn't it be great if you could just click on the name of the article and it would take you to that other article? And that doesn't sound like a big deal now, but when the web was developed, that was like revolutionary. It's like, wow. We don't have to go and trudge the library and go and see if this library has it and not visit another library and so on and so forth. No. You could just click on things and be taken to that paper. All right. So it was a revolutionary idea, and it really was the genesis of the modern web. The idea of hypertext is when we talk about hypertext, we're talking about beyond text. So web pages have more than just plain text. They have images, they have multimedia, and probably most importantly, they have links to other web pages. All right? Yet, if you view a web page, it's just a plain text file. All right? You can go and look. Again, I wish I had a projector. We could open up a web page and we could find the words of a link and stuff like that on a web page. So how do we take this text document and bring it to life so it's a hypertext document that contains images and links and other multimedia? It's through the use of what's called a markup language. The idea of markup languages is this. You can put text in a file, and you can put things called tags around the text to tell web browsers what that content is. All right? It's very similar to be like if you were highlighting your textbook, right? You're tagging your textbook, right? If you have a highlighter or a pen or whatever. So, take a look at this document. This is security instructions. Let's say this was something in an employee manual and someone was giving a presentation about it. They might say, well, this policy changed. This is no longer the policy in effect. If this was my copy, what would I do? I'd put a big X through it, saying, hey, I marked it up. I took my employee manual and marked it up with a tag, a big old X that says, hey, that's no longer important. Maybe this one is extra important. Maybe this section of the page is extra important. What might I do about it? I might highlight it, put stars next to it. Somehow I could mark up this sheet of paper to add additional meaning. All right? And that's exactly what we do in HTML documents. HTML documents are plain text documents. They're not Word documents. They're not like Excel documents. They're plain text. So any formatting you put in them is the formatting that you put in based on the tags. In this class, we're going to create our web pages using either Notepad or Notepad++ you're welcome to use. So you're going to go in and you're going to open up Notepad or open up Notepad++ and write your HTML code. All right? Let's talk about some of the things that are in HTML code. And as I'm doing this, I will create an example that you won't be able to see now, but I'll upload it so that you will be able to see it. You'll be able to download it and see it. For now, I'm just going to write up on the board. So I'm going to open up Notepad. And this is going to be the browser. Now I put two things up on the board, but keep in mind there aren't two documents. There's only one document. There's only one HTML document for a web page. All right? We're going to look at it two different ways. We're going to look at it in Notepad, and we're going to look at it in the web browser. And what is the web browser? The web browser is simply a piece of software that takes an HTML document and sort of brings it to life. It takes the tags and displays them in the proper way. So if you have an image tag, it makes a picture on the screen. If you have a link tag, it makes it so that it's clickable and that you have a link. All right? So let's start talking about the tags that you put into your HTML page. And let's talk about how it will look if we view it in the browser. Again, we're only talking about one file. We're not talking about two files, just one. All right, I'm going to start out with an incomplete HTML page. All right? Either today or Thursday, I'll talk about some other tags that you need in addition to the ones that we have here. But for now, I'm going to make an incomplete web page. All right? And let me draw what I want the page to look like. I'm going to want the web page to look like when I view it in the browser, computer information systems, I want that to be big. In fact, let me write it bigger. This is a headline. This is a top-level heading of the page. If I was making an outline, this would be like the top thing on it. So we have in, at LC, we have four different computer information systems programs. And maybe I want those headings to be a little bit smaller. So we have mobile application development. We have software development. And we have networking. think about it in terms of an outline, right? If I was doing a web page about the Computer Information Systems Program here at Loring Community, the main topic of the page would be Computer Information Systems at LCCC. That's the main topic. It's going to be displayed the biggest, right? Because it's sort of human nature to expect the most important things to be displayed big and the more detailed things to be in a small one. So, Computer Information System consists of four different programs. These four programs. All right, these four associate's degrees. And they're also headings, right? They're also going to be headings for a section. This is sort of the heading for the entire page. It's sort of like the top heading about everything. This is sort of a second level heading. And then maybe I'll have a paragraph about each of these that'll be in just ordinary font. And I'll just write real small a few words. You might have a paragraph for each of these things. Alright. So, we're not going to develop a complete web page. We're just going to develop a part of a web page. Alright. So, what we're going to do. Now, notice a couple things. Notice that the tag comes in a pair. There's two parts to a tag. There's this, and there's this. What's the difference between this and this? This has a slash in front of the H1. This is what's called a starting tag. This is what's called an ending tag. And in most instances, tags always go together in pairs. For every starting tag, there's going to be an ending tag. Keep in mind there's exceptions for everything, but as a general rule, for every starting tag, there's going to be an ending tag. What do the starting and ending tags say? They say, well, here's where the heading begins, Here's where the heading ends. All right? So it knows that anything after it is no longer part of that heading. All right? So the content that we have here is no longer part of this heading because we've ended the heading. Likewise, later on when we study links and we look at how links are constructed, if we make a line of text a link, if we forget to close the link tag, then the entire web page becomes a link. And that's probably not a good idea, right? You probably just want a few words to be a link. So the ending tag says where this ends. And so anything that ends after it, or anything that's after it, doesn't count. Again, it'd be like if I highlighted something. If these three lines were really important, I would highlight the first three lines. Where I started highlighting, I would know is important. Where I ended highlighting, I would know is important. Is where the important part ended, rather. So that's our first tag. Our second tag is an H2 tag. Now, the H2 tag doesn't mean that it's the second heading on the page. The H2 tag means it's the second level heading. Again, think about like if you were making an outline for English class. You have your main topic. Underneath your main topic, you have a second level topic. So part of CISS at Lorraine CCC is the web development program. I could then have a third heading underneath web development, and then a fourth heading underneath that, and so on down the line. I could have a bunch of third-level headings underneath web development. But H2 means it's a second-level heading. And by default, second-level headings are displayed a little bit smaller than the main heading. Alright? So I'll get a page that looks like this. Finally, if I just have some text that isn't a heading, but it's like a paragraph about something. Like in this case, maybe I've explained the web development program. It will be in a P tag. Sentences here, and I'll put the NP there. So it was our first three tags, H1, H2, and a paragraph tag. An H1 simply means it's a top-level heading. An H2 means it's a second-level heading. An H3 means it's a third-level heading. A P tag simply means it's a paragraph of information. What I suggest students in the online class watching this is to open up the document that I am going to upload to Canvas. Now I want to point out a couple of things. First of all, so imagine if I was typing this into Notepad or Notepad++. Notice how this is in two lines. All right? Notice how this paragraph is broken down into several lines. That doesn't matter to the browser. Anything other than characters that you type in, whether they be spaces or returns or anything like that, are what is called white space. And all white space in a web page is sort of smashed down into a single space. So in other words, I could put each of these words on its own line. It would still display in the browser like this. All right? Because it doesn't matter how many extra spaces I have. It's just going to turn all the extra spaces between words into one space. All right? And if that will fit in the browser window, it'll display as one line across. If you make the browser window smaller, it will then wrap it around. And it does that for you automatically. The browser does that for you automatically. The H1 and H2, however, even if they were on the same line, even if I put this H2 right here, right after the H1, in the web browser, it would still display as being in separate lines. That's because H1s and H2s are what are called block tags. And block tags always display in the browser on a new line. All three of these tags are block tags. So it doesn't matter how I space this out. I can literally write everything, all this code, on a single line, and it would display like this. All right, up to here. Where this is on its own line, this is on its own line, this is on its own line. So the extra spaces that you have don't matter. It does matter, however, a little bit to you, because by putting in spaces, you can make your code more readable. All right? You can make your code more readable. If your code is more readable, it will be easier for you to go back and change later on. So, for example, if I entered this in as one giant line that had thousands of characters in it, if we added a fifth category here, it would be very difficult to figure out how to put it between here and there. If I space things out like this, it will be a lot easier to read. It will be easier to make the changes. So you want to format your code so it looks very readable. The other thing that we have is tags don't overlap with each other. This is called proper nesting. In other words, this is not legal. Why? Well, it's not nested properly. Another way to say it is, if a tag will only finish in a tag if it starts within a tag. So in this case, I have an H1 tag that ends inside the H2 tag. Well, it didn't start within the H2 tag, so it can't end there. So that would be illegal. Now, when I say it's illegal, does it mean that you'll get arrested? Yes, you will. Actually, a policeman will come to... No, I'm just kidding about that. What do I mean when I say it's illegal? It means that it might not behave the way that you would want it to in the browser. It might, or it might not. It's sort of like making a grammatical error if I give instructions. If I make a grammatical error, you still might figure out what I'm asking you to do. Or if I make a bad enough grammatical error, maybe you won't have any idea what I'm supposed to do. The browser's the same way. All right? Sometimes it will understand what you mean, even though you got the language wrong. Other times it won't understand it and will display it incorrectly. Now, you are not ready to complete Lab 1. You will be ready after Thursday to complete Lab 1. Lab 1 requires you to go on the web and look for some information about a set of topics. HTML, web design, CSS, I think those are the three topics. So even if you're not ready to write the HTML code, you can start finding those links to resources. What I would suggest for you to do is try to duplicate what I did here. And here's how you'll do it. You open up Notepad or Notepad++. You'll enter this in, just like I have it here. You'll save it as a .html document. That's important. So you can save it as something .html. But you can't save it as a .txt file. You have to save it as a .html file. That will give you a web page. To open it up in the browser, simply find it, like if you save it on your desktop, find it on your desktop, double click on it, and then it will open up in the browser. And you'll see it like this. All right. We will go over this again next time. Hopefully by then, the projector will be fixed so I can actually show and demonstrate these things. But again, until then, two things that you can do in lab. One of them is start looking up, you know, reading the assigned materials and looking at Lab 1 and starting to find your websites for Lab 1. And the second thing you can try to do is try to duplicate this and see if you can get to the same point that I did. Keep in mind, again, this is not a complete web page. This is sort of a fragment of a web page. We'll also talk about how to finish this up next time. All right, we'll see you over in Lab, which is in BU202.
Excuse me, Mike.
Yes.
Is a lab assignment separate from homework assignment?
Lab and homework assignment are the same.
Okay.
Yeah.